speaker today is Sherry Chen.
Thank you for having me. When I was 11 years old, I had a near-death experience. And I was in Ocean City, Maryland. There was a cruise liner, and this rarely happens, but a cruise liner came close to the shore and created a lot of waves. I was very adventurous, even though I was a very shy little girl. And so I decided to go out on a surfboard with another boy that I didn't know. And I got on his shoulders, and that's when the lifeguard said, "Well, you need to come back." And he said, "Do you know how to dive?" And I said, "Sure." And I sort of did. But he said, "I have to dive first, and you have to dive after me." And he dove first, and I dove afterwards, and I was taken by the undertow or the current at the time. And when a near-death experience happens when you're 11 years old, it was an experience that you can't put into words at first. And I had eventually, afterwards, decided that I was going to go to a library and try to pick out books that I might understand reincarnation, I might learn about all sorts of things that had happened to me. And this is a short synopsis of what occurred. But I wanted to tell you what I learned from my near-death experience. And then I'll go into briefly what happened. So, time is 0 point, and distance is no point, and space is collapsible energy. And that's where space becomes dimensions. We are light, and light bends, and like the circle behind me, it has no beginning and no discernible end. It is the Alpha, the Omega. We ascend like gyrating and swirling upward, like a bird that is riding an air current, always ever upward. There are various frequencies, and like being in a fog, it can seem lengthened and slow. Or when you are happily engaged in a situation, time seems to be very quick. It speeds up. God is like an accordion, a breath in, a breath out. It extends into many, and then it refolds into one. It gives, and it receives. There are billions of planets. Life is abundant with its own specific state of consciousness. Each planet has a consciousness. And every one of us do critical work for our universe, for our planet. And we create a bigger dream. A near-death experience has led me to an internal alchemy. Events unfold like a movie reel. There is no stretch of time, such as past, present, and future. Taking responsibility for one's own emotions, you will not have to revisit them or become addicted to drama. Instead, the adversities will equal solutions, and they do come in time when you are quiet and still. What you think matters, it becomes matter, and it moves into matter. And that's why it's really important to actually focus on what you want to create and not what is in the news or the media or happening even in your own neighborhood. Because unless something is renewed or revitalized, nothing changes. So I'll go into a little bit about my experience, and I did write it down, but we'll only do a little of it, and then if you have any questions. After I dove into the water, my ears perceived an incredible sound. I felt like I was eavesdropping on a majestic concert, all languages, voices, instruments becoming one in harmony, It was a tribute, and it was my musical eulogy. This, I thought, was surpassing Frank Sinatra's greatest hits. Perhaps sailors were heralded in by the very echo of what they thought were sea sirens. In any case, it engaged my attention. I felt luxurious, exuberant, indulged, and took flight into a tunnel of light and beings. These beings knew me, were of me, no need to maintain separateness as here on earth. At the quick halt of a moment, two monks stood erect in front of me. They talked telepathically amongst themselves, and I asked, "Am I dead?" In reply, they responded, "I think, therefore I am." "Ah, I'm still thinking. I guess I'm still alive." Surrounded by an amber glow, their braided ropes on their robes came alive with a vein of gold. They were monks, and their robes and their braids seemed alive, fluid, flowing. With ease, I understood that they were my guides, and they were my guides in this continuing lifetime. In procession, I was taken to a room with a massive screen to review my life. They were a witness to my development of spirit, misfortune, triumph, and parade of episodes, and the inevitable consequences of my decisions. I was scanned, my whole life was scanned on this film, and the monks cared for me and nurtured my response as they touched my shoulder. Certain scenes were paused that pertained to my life that I may collect and meditate on information, and a particular person was shown, and I could glimpse their emotions and the effect that I had on them. My guides were tender and sensitive to my reactions of each slide or event displayed. My body was a transparent, yet did have a form. My eyes were the window of my soul, and it radiated my spirit. It became clear that what I did here, so shall be in heaven. I learned we are the judges of our misdeeds or great fortune and how our lives interact with others. We are the will, and God is allowing. In the smallest interaction, in interactions, there is meaning and definition. In God's launching of creation, we are light, pledging to participate and breathe in the spark of life. We inherit a family to establish a relation, or many, thus we become kinship. When we love totally, we then may aid others and accomplish and even learn our own lessons. We own our emotions when we control them and can channel them into a positive direction. Through these guides, I was given the opportunity to view the world. And rather than being in a room with several windows, I was encased by none. Possibilities became endless, and I understood with such depth belying my age of 11. Life proceeds continuously, even unbroken, just as nature will cycle and recycle. Spellbound by what happened next, I was in a mosque. It was white marble, and it glittered, and it looked so pristine. It was exceedingly grand with an oval table, and to the side of it was a podium, a reading stand with a book, a huge book of long literary works. Male entities were in council, and they looked very scholarly with their white beards and their robes. And with their encouragement, I opened the recorded charts on every living being and history. I felt it was privileged information and revealing lives in that very second. I pondered the meaning of it all, and I speculated the designer of life and knew that I was part of this equation. These wise men conveyed that all was one, and one became more as we chose to separate ourselves, duality of male and female. This caused a bit of anxiety, and our cells remember this. We are distinct beings from our source, and yet are the source. We separated our oneness to become interrelated to another, to serve outside of ourselves. And instead of being androgynous, we became like Adam and Eve. The event that occurred provoked tyranny, for eventually men used women for sensual preference. And this also created doctrines that held power over people that became the policy of society. Thus, we were not allowed to be our unique selves. Now it's understood to say, does this work or doesn't it work? For each scenario is unique and different. These wise men taught me that love represents the exceptional, extraordinary nature of its ideal. And to love is a verb. It propels itself out of every existence. Love is the equilibrium. We have components of male and female traits. Judge no one, and to whom you love. As if charged by a current, I was then situated in a park. Jesus and little children were conversing with laughter. The sound was like bells ringing. He summons me to join them, and I was conscious that I had lived many lives, that I was ancient. And I couldn't understand why he would summon me when I'm so old and you're so young. I was conscious that I had lived many lives, eons and lifetimes, in fact, and felt ancient as God itself. I felt far advanced in years to assemble with these young children. And then, Jesus had an incredibly imposing smile spread across his cheekbones as he said, "Aren't you a child of God? Aren't you a child of God?" So it had nothing to do with your age or your experiences. We are all children of God. And I thought that Jesus was quite witty to say that, and humorous, in fact, and he laughed. And this was inviting and charming, and it was Jesus. Jesus exuded stamina. I was astonished at these events, and during his existence on earth, he emulated unbiased opinions. He taught that an earnest request in prayer was heard, and the direction was forthcoming. He was always in preparation, adapting, making provisions, improving himself, and helping others. Words are feeble to describe Jesus, as he was void of any vanity. He had beautiful brown and red hair that cloaked his shoulders, and the eyes expressed ardor, and they were bright blue with brown around them. His skin tone was medium, he wasn't light, and he wasn't dark. I was impressed with his tall appearance and capable hands with long fingers. Neither did his broad chest or vigorous manners alarm. He was altogether tranquil with a ready grin. Had I no sooner smiled back and was there, then I stood in a crowd of angelic beings. It was as if I was in a football stadium, and the cheering and roaring were for a favorite team. It was as if the stadium opened up and I could see all of these planets. Everyone was excited. The angels demonstrated that the whole complex was about to be coming. Everything was in change, and every planet was in growth. It is in our favor to move towards this excitement. We have a multitude of support with guides, angels, saints, and God. What I was shown is that we are allowed to attend and follow the lives of those we love on a particular planet. And that is why we feel our loved ones when they do pass over on the other side, because they are allowed to see us, and if they so desire. It's a gift from God. In our universe is a universe and another with entities that govern this or that planet, and they have access to watching over them as guardians. So there's guardians of every planet, every being. No one is alone, and nothing is alone. If I had struggled with what was happening to me, or I questioned it, I felt like this beautiful vision would have ended. And it was displayed through my life review that I may have a difficult time in the future when I became older. And they taught me how to react with the best intentions and to remain strong. The event was not something I was happy about, but to this day, I made it through the grace with God. And in exchange, I know that it is more interesting to change form than to remain always as we are. The incredible discovery is always of self. If love is our origin and your origin is God, then who are we? What exceptional alternatives can we share to improve our planet and care for one another that few have dared to go beyond? And so my story continues, but I wanted to do a couple of things if we have time briefly. I wanted to say the things that we can vision with our own hearts. See the world where weapons are obsolete and decayed. There is nothing left to defend. feel liberated from fear. Also, visualize the preservation of life in every form, everywhere. Allow heaven to be a link to earth as each generation surpasses anything known to them before. And wed with love in union and regeneration of the soul, which is God's legacy to all of us. And so I have a very brief meditation. And this is about trusting yourself, because so often, and this is what I learned on the other side of my near-death experience, is to trust ourselves, because that small inner voice, when we're rational, when we're sane, when we're balanced and a little bit unemotional at that time, and we go inside and we just listen, often you have the answers already there. So I'd like everyone to close their eyes. And I want you to trust your instincts. Visualize that you're standing on a lush, green, high mountain, way, way up. It could be Tibet, it could be Telos, it can be anywhere at all. And you will feel a slight warm breeze caressing your skin. It is calming. And now you look down. And you see all the people who are part of your life. Go ahead and observe them. How do they react towards you? How do you react towards them? Observe even closer. Which ones do you trust? Which ones do you love? Which ones can be newfound friends? Which ones bring you sadness? Go ahead, and whomever you would like to talk with, do it now, and visualize that you are sharing a beautiful, glorious moment with them. Do you feel neutral? Do you feel repelled? Do you feel loving? Or remorse? Trust your instincts. And at your interaction with each person, give thanks. Thank them for being a part of your life, no matter what they bring to your life, no matter what you've brought to their life. So much of illness is caused by unforgiveness. Perhaps being down from this mountain and observing these people who are part of your life, you are able now to forgive. And now you are rejuvenated. Give thanks for everyone. And so it is. And now you may go back to the mountain, the top of the mountain, and review all your feelings and who you met along the way. And you can repeat this meditation by interacting and talking with them peacefully. You can have a greater understanding of the other person. And best of all, you will learn to trust
your instincts.
You may open your eyes. And I hope you enjoy today as I have. Are there any questions? Yeah.
Physically, so you almost drowned?
I did, yes. What happened is, which is really interesting, one of the first sensations is, there is a thing called the many mansions, and I used to think they were the rings of Saturn, that we would go through the rings of Saturn if we were practically invisible as a child, because I was trying to relate and understand this. But I went through many realms. This is only the beginning of what I got to experience. So when I came out of the water, I was lifted by an angelic being, and I had very, very long hair. And one of the things I was upset about was that I had no energy to even move my hair, and it was straight in front of me as I was lifted out of the water. And then, where was the boy that I was with? He was nowhere in sight. And what happened to the lifeguard? Didn't he see me go under? So there were all these questions, and it seemed like I had lived a lifetime, and yet everything was the same. And I also felt very, very heavy in this body, and even angry that I returned. It was difficult, and for the first year, I couldn't concentrate because I was trying to find out all the information I could. So Edgar Cayce fell off a bookshelf right in front of my feet, and it was called There Is a River. So that was the start of one book. And eventually I did go there, and I did get tested for various things and psychic ability and all those things, and I rated very highly. But I think when you're having a near-death experience, it opens you up to other experiences. And so that's what I think I became a little bit more intuitive than before. And when I came out of the water, feeling that heaviness like an elephant, like I was a two-ton elephant, is an amazing feeling to feel the contrast of how heavy it is to carry this body, to carry this, from where we all came from, being just solar. So that was a very interesting factor in my life. So for the first year, I was so distracted that I actually was put back in fifth grade because I couldn't concentrate on my studies. There was just too much that I wanted to answer and had too many questions. It didn't have anything to do with spelling at the time. Anyone else?
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank
you.
So
your entire life?
Pardon me?
You saw your entire life play out?
I saw what's called maybe what they call now the Akash records. I felt like I was intruding. You know, my parents taught me to have very good manners. And when I opened this book, I could see history played out. And I loved Joan of Arc, you know, as a little girl. So I could see Joan of Arc. Every page was like alive and moving, and I could see history. So I saw history and other people's lives. And I said, oh, I can't do that. And I'm like, no, go right ahead, enjoy yourself. It was that kind of a thing. And my life, I saw only one future event that was very important that I meet and go through. And I fought them on this on the other side. I said, I don't understand. Why do I have to go through this? You know? And they said, well, it's just one of the things that you have to go through. So they warned me in a way so that I would have the courage to go through this and come out fairly successful. And I did. And I remember, you know, the funny thing is that for a long time I hadn't remembered that until this incident happened. And I was very, very heartbroken. So then I remembered. It came back to me how loved I was. And I was shown that this is a possibility, and it did occur, and that I was to get through it, and I did. And it is all with the grace of God. And we all have guides and beings that watch over us and our loved ones, and it's a whole crew. It really is, and it's amazing. I wish everyone could know that. So I've never felt alone afterwards. I've never felt alone ever.
My twin had a near-death experience of almost drowning, and she said her entire life passed before her.
Well, on the screen.
She could see everything that had happened to her.
Yes, actually that is true. That with that screen, yes, I see what you're getting at. Yes, that was shown to me. But what was interesting to me, it wasn't how I felt, it was how I made other people feel. And that's what got me about this sea in my life. I thought, oh, this is how I feel. And they're like, no, no, no. It's how you make other people feel. So I got to feel, like for one little thing that happened, because I was young and I could interpret it, they showed me a little boy. My parents loved to go to the racetracks in Monticello. And there was a little boy on a white picket fence. And he was waving to everybody on the highway, but it looked like everybody was ignoring him. So as we went by, I took my hand and I went like this. And they let me feel the joy in that boy that I just acknowledged him. That one little thing brought him such exuberant joy that it was like, you know? Mm-hmm. And so I understood that all of us play a very major role in each other's lives. And it can be a stranger who drops a tissue and you help pick up that tissue and you give it to him. As simple as something like that. It matters. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does.
Thank you.
Thank you.
No, I swear.
Does anyone know this song, My Sweet Lord by George Harrison?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. It's an oldie but goodie. For me, it's an oldie one. No. I was 2 years old when it came out. 1970.
Go ahead, drop it in.
1970. Yeah. So, once we get going into this song, there's the hallelujahs. You're welcome to sing along on the easy parts like that. And then there's a chant towards the end. And the Hare Krishna has the same melody as the Hallelujah. And then the Guru Brahma chant after that. I put on your sheets the translation of that, because that's in Sanskrit. That little part he does at the end, Guru Brahma. Tasmai Shri. She asked me how to say it. Yeah, so that chant it's a Sanskrit chant. Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo, Maheshwara, Guru Sakshat, Param Brahma, Tasmai Shri, Guru Namah. Sometimes it's say Guru Ve Namaha. Because I wrote a song based on that chant in the past, so the way I sang it was Guru Ve Namaha. Mm-hmm. But the way George Harrison's song sings it is Guru Namah, the same meaning. And so I put the translation at the bottom there for that chant, because it has a really nice meaning. So do you want to take a second to look that over?
Thank you.